Upfront Books presents The Cambridge History of Warfare, edited by Geoffrey Parker and narrated by Andrew Cullum. With your purchase of this audiobook, you have received a PDF to complement your listening experience. In this PDF, you will find 23 maps that cover everything from the Peloponnesian War all the way to the war against ISIS, as well as a list of major dates and events in chronological order. Feel free to pause the audiobook now and visit upfrontbooks.com/warfare to download the PDF. Introduction. The Western Way of War, written by Geoffrey Parker. Every culture develops its own way of war. Societies where land is plentiful but manpower is scarce tend to favour a ritualised conflict in which only a few warriors actually fight, but their fate decides that of everyone. The flower wars of the Aztecs and the Amok combats of the Indonesian islanders caused relatively little bloodshed because they aimed to seize people rather than territory. To increase each warlord's available manpower rather than waste it in bloody battles. With or without battles, however, as the Prussian officer and military theorist Karl von Clausewitz wrote in the 1820s, war is always an act of force to compel the enemy to do our will. Many non-Western military traditions have displayed great continuity over time. Even in the 1960s, anthropologists could study the highland peoples of Irian Jaya in Indonesia, who still settled their disputes in the same ritualized way as their ancestors. But by then, most other military cultures had been transformed by that of Europe and the former European colonies in the Americas. The Western way of war, which also boasts great antiquity, rests upon five principal foundations: technology, discipline, an aggressive military tradition, eclecticism, and finance. The primacy of technology and discipline. The armed forces of the West have always placed heavy reliance on superior technology, usually to compensate for inferior numbers. That is not to say that the West enjoyed universal technological superiority. Until the advent of musketry volleys and field artillery in the early 17th century, the recurved bow used by horse archers all over Asia proved far more effective than any Western weaponry. Nevertheless, with few exceptions, the horse archers of Asia did not directly threaten the West, and when they did, the threat was not sustained. Nor did all the advanced technology originate in the West. Many vital innovations, including the stirrup and gunpowder, came from Eastern adversaries. Military technology is usually the first to be borrowed by every society, because the penalty for failing to do so can be immediate and fatal. But the West seems to have been preternaturally receptive to new technology, whether from its own inventors or from outside. Technological innovation, and the equally vital ability to respond to it, soon became an established feature of Western warfare. A technological edge has rarely been sufficient in itself to ensure victory. As the Swiss military writer Antoine-Henri Jomini wrote in the early 19th century, "The superiority of armament may increase the chances of success in war, but it does not of itself win battles." Even in the 20th century, the outcome of wars was determined less by technology than by better war plans, the achievement of surprise, greater economic strength, and above all, superior discipline. Western military practice has always exalted discipline as the primary instrument that turns bands of men fighting as individuals into soldiers fighting as part of organized units. Naturally, the other factors play their part in the West as elsewhere, notably kinship, religion, patriotism, and gender. Many military formations, even in the 18th century, came from the same area and served under their local leaders almost as an extended family. The Protestant cause proved a potent rallying cry for much of the 16th and 17th centuries in Northern Europe, and "Your country needs you," and similar slogans, have assisted recruiting down to our own days. A survivor of the Italian Expeditionary Force sent by Benito Mussolini to fight in the Soviet Union in 1942 recalled that our ethic was the honor of our hometown, of our valley, of our battalion, which included our school friends, our cousins, the brothers of our sweethearts. That is what made us such magnificent warriors. Nevertheless, in the West, discipline, in the twin forms of drill and long-term service, has incorporated and transcended all other concepts. The hoplites of 5th-century Greece, who were farmers first and soldiers second, turned out so regularly for battle in their phalanxes that they perfected a high degree of combat effectiveness, because the critical element of discipline is the ability of a formation to stand fast in the face of the enemy, whether attacking or being attacked, without giving way to the natural impulses of fear and panic. Repeated group activities, whether directly related to combat, firing practice, or not, square bashing, all have the effect of creating artificial kinship groups. Some of them, like the cohort, the company, and the platoon, further reinforced by the creation of small fellowships within the unit in order to increase cohesion, and therefore combat efficiency, even further. Once again, the crucial advantage lay in the ability to compensate for numerical inferiority, for whether defending Europe from invasion, as at Plataea in 479 BC, at the Lechfeld in AD 955, or at Vienna in AD 1683, or in subduing the Aztecs, Incas, and Mughals, Western forces have always been outnumbered by 2 to 1, and often by far more. Without superb discipline, as well as advanced technology, these odds would have proved overwhelming. Even Alexander the Great and his 50,000 Greek and Macedonian troops could scarcely have destroyed the forces of the Persian Empire in the 4th century BC without superior discipline, since the armies of his adversaries probably included more Greek soldiers fighting with much the same equipment. Discipline proved particularly important for Western armies in another way because, with surprisingly few exceptions, their wars have normally been won by infantry. The long reign of the hoplites and the legionaries was followed by a millennium in which men fighting on foot won most of the battles and bore the brunt of the more numerous sieges. The rise of missile weapons, first bows and then firearms, served only to reinforce the trend. However, withstanding a full cavalry charge without flinching always required arduous training, strong unit cohesion, and superb self-control. The same was true of war at sea. Whether resisting boarding parties on a galley or enduring a cannonade aboard a ship of the line, discipline and training proved essential. Continuity in Western military thinking. Reinforcing these elements, and indeed refining them, is a remarkable continuity in Western military thinking. The history of a compendium of Roman military practice concerning military matters, first composed by Flavius Renatus Vegetius around the year 390 AD and revised into its final form about 50 years later, offers perhaps the most remarkable example. In the early 8th century, the Northumbrian scholar Bede, on the northwestern fringe of the former Roman world, had probably seen a copy. In the 9th century, the Carolingian ruler Lothar I commissioned an abridgment of the work to help him devise a successful strategy for resisting the Viking invasions. And in 1147, during a siege, Count Geoffrey Plantagenet of Anjou constructed and used an incendiary device thanks to a reading of Vegetius. The sustained popularity of Concerning Military Matters is further attested by the survival of more than 200 medieval manuscripts and translations into many vernacular languages, English, French, German, Italian, Portuguese, and Spanish, starting in the late 13th century. An English translation appeared in 1767, and the young George Washington possessed and annotated a copy. Other classical works on military affairs also enjoyed enduring popularity and influence. In AD 1594, Maurice of Nassau and his cousins in the Netherlands devised the crucial innovation of volley fire for muskets after reading the account in Elian's Tactics, written circa AD 100, of the techniques employed by the javelin and slingshot throwers of the Roman army, and spent the next decade introducing to their troops the drills practiced by the legions. In the 19th century, Napoleon III and Helmut von Moltke both translated the campaign histories of Julius Caesar, written almost 2,000 years earlier, while Count Alfred von Schlieffen and his successors in the Prussian General Staff expressly modelled their strategy for destroying France in the next war upon the tactic so triumphantly used by Hannibal at the Battle of Cannae in 216 BC. In 1914 it came within an ace of success. In 1940, it secured the defeat of France. More recently still, General George C. Marshall argued that a soldier should begin his military education by reading Thucydides' History of the Peloponnesian War, written almost 2,500 years before. The open-ended dedication to the study of military history was itself a form of technological superiority. Such striking continuities derive from the fact that ancient theorists and modern practitioners of war shared not only a love of precedent and a conviction that past examples could and should influence present practice, but also eclecticism, a willingness to accept and implement ideas from all quarters. Religious and ideological constraints have seldom interfered with either the conduct or the discussion of war in the West. On the one hand, until the 19th century, the laws of war were normally couched in very general terms and lacked any effective machinery of enforcement. On the other hand, from Plato's Academy down to the modern war colleges, censorship in the West, both religious and secular, has been generally absent, allowing the full systematization of knowledge. Certain core ideas have therefore remained remarkably constant. These include not only the emphasis on the need for superior technology and discipline, but also a vision of war centered on winning a decisive victory that brought about the enemy's unconditional surrender. As Clausewitz put it, the direct annihilation of the enemy's forces must always be the dominant consideration because destruction of the enemy forces is the overriding principle of war. Other theorists, however, stressed an alternative strategy for achieving total victory, attrition, of which the military history of the West also offers abundant examples. Fabius Cunctator, the delayer of Rome, whose reliance on time, the friction of campaigning, and the superior marshalling of resources eventually reversed the verdict of Cannae, the Duke of Alba in the service of 16th century Spain, Erich von Falkenhayn in World War I. Yet the overall aim of Western strategy, whether by battle, siege, or attrition, almost always remained the total defeat and destruction of the enemy, and this contrasted starkly with the military practice of many other societies. Many classical writers commented on the utter ruthlessness of hoplites and legionaries, and in the early modern period the phrase bellum Romanum, the Roman way of war, acquired the sense of war without mercy and became the standard military technique of Europeans abroad. Thus, the indigenous inhabitants of New England strongly disapproved of the colonists' way of war. "It is too furious and slays too many men," one warrior told an English captain reproachfully in the 1630s. The captain did not deny it. "I dare boldly affirm that the Pequots, Narragansett, and others must fight 7 years and not kill 7 men, because they fought more for pastime than to conquer and subdue enemies." A decade later, Roger Williams, a colonial governor, opined that the Indians' wars are far less bloody and devouring than the cruel wars of Europe, and seldom 20 slain in a pitched field. In 1788, West African warlords informed European observers that the sole object of their wars was to procure slaves, as they could not obtain European goods without slaves, and they could not get slaves without fighting for them. Clearly, peoples who fought to enslave, rather than to exterminate their enemies, would, like the indigenous inhabitants of the Americas, Southeast Asia, and Siberia before them, prove ill-prepared to withstand the unfamiliar tactics of destruction employed against them by the Europeans. Eclecticism. The steady spread of Western military power rested on far more than the triad of technology, discipline, and aggressive military tradition. Many other military traditions, such as those of China and Japan, also placed a high premium on technology and discipline, and the teachings of Sun Tzu in the 6th century BC strikingly anticipated many positions later developed by Clausewitz and Jomini. However, the West differed in two crucial aspects: its unique eclecticism, allowing the adoption and integration of new military practices as need arose, and to fund every change. Areas dominated by a single hegemonic power, such as Tokugawa Japan or Mughal India, faced relatively few life-threatening challenges, and so military traditions changed slowly, if at all. But in areas contested by multiple polities, the need for military innovation could become extremely strong. Admittedly, when the states remained relatively underdeveloped, with backward political and economic institutions and infrastructures, the tension between challenge and response seldom resulted in rapid and significant change. But where competing states were both numerous and institutionally strong, the challenge and response dynamic could become self-sustaining, with growth, in effect, begetting growth. Military historian Clifford J. Rogers has compared this mechanism to the concept in evolutionary biology known as punctuated equilibrium, in which development proceeds by short bursts of rapid change interspersed with longer periods of slower, incremental alteration. Thus, in the 14th century, after a long period in which infantry had slowly but steadily increased its importance, Swiss pikemen and English archers suddenly and dramatically enhanced its role. Then, after about a century of experiment, gunpowder artillery began in the 1430s to revolutionize siegecraft. And about a century after that, following constant and extremely expensive experiment, a new defensive technique known as the artillery fortress brought positional warfare back into balance. Each innovation broke the prevailing equilibrium and provoked a phase of rapid transformation and adjustment. The ability to adopt and reproduce unfamiliar military techniques and tactics required more than changes in the art of war. Above all, any military system based upon maintaining a technological edge is, by definition, expensive in terms of financial and human capital. Labor-intensive systems, which rely for their impact upon concentrating an overwhelming number of men, may only require a society to mobilize its adult males, probably for a brief period, equipped with traditional weapons. Sometimes, as in the case of Japanese or early medieval swords, weapons of considerable antiquity that could, like Excalibur, be reused. The financial burden of fighting may therefore be spread over a wide social group, and even over several generations. A capital-intensive military system, by contrast, requires the stockpiling of military hardware, a wide panoply of weapons that, although extremely expensive, may soon become outdated, as well as military software, military theory, tactics, and specialized skill sets. Not only the latest equipment, but also the knowledge to use it to maximum effect. The principal attraction of capital-intensive warfare, however, lay in the combination of high initial cost with low maintenance. Thus, Harlech Castle, one of the vast fortifications constructed by Edward I in Wales, cost almost an entire year's revenue to build, but in 1294 its garrison of only 37 soldiers successfully defended it against attack. The king's strategic vision anticipated that of the Manhattan Project, which spent millions of dollars in the production of atomic devices, which, delivered on two August mornings in 1945 by just two American bombers, precipitated the unconditional surrender of Imperial Japan and the millions of its troops still in arms all over Southeast Asia. After the introduction of gunpowder weapons and complex fortifications, the cost of each war proved significantly higher than that of the last, while the cost of military hardware rose to such a degree that only a centralized state could afford to buy. Creating the means to fund such an expensive form of warfare clearly served to enhance the power of the state in the West, with each change in the size or equipment of armed forces requiring both new efforts to extract resources from the subject population and an expanded bureaucratic structure to handle them. Naturally, prolonged financial pressure often provoked opposition among those required to pay, but that too could lead to increased control and therefore increased internal power by the state over its subjects, making possible further military innovations and developments. This proved particularly true of wars waged to gain or extend hegemony, which required the steady transfer of money and munitions raised by the central government to distant theatres, since this simultaneously promoted higher taxes, greater borrowing, and increased integration. Military activity and state formation in the West therefore became inextricably linked. States made war, but wars also made and could sometimes break states. To use another biological analogy, one is reminded of the double helix structure of the DNA molecule, with two complex spirals interacting at various discrete points. The complexity of this image serves as a reminder that imitating the Western way of war involved adaptation at many levels. Simply copying weapons picked up on the battlefield could never suffice. It also required the replication of the entire social and economic structure that underpinned the capacity to innovate and respond swiftly. Westernizing war depended upon the ability of warriors, traditionally one of the most conservative groups, to accept both the need for change and the need for instruction from inventors from a different and normally inferior social background. It also presupposed an ability on the part of the state to mobilize resources rapidly in large quantities and often for long periods so that any technological inferiorities revealed in the course of the conflict could be remedied in time. Naturally, the less developed the economy, the less easily the cost of military preparedness could be absorbed, even within the West. Thus, in 1904, France spent 36% of its budget on the army, whereas Germany spent 20%. However, in real terms, this meant that France spent 38 million francs, as against 99 million francs by Germany. France thus devoted twice as much of its budget in order to spend only half as much as its major rival. The continuation of this pattern for much of the next decade helps to explain why France found itself at such a disadvantage when war broke out in 1914. The introduction of ingenious new taxes and other means of instant wealth extraction proved no less important for feeding Mars than the development of new techniques for mobilizing credit, such as national banks, banknotes, letters of credit, and bonds, because few states ever managed to finance a major war out of current income, creating and, even more, conserving an adequate credit base proved highly elusive, however. In the evocative phrase of an English political economist, Charles Davenant, writing in 1698, "Of all beings that have existence only in the minds of men, nothing is more fantastical and nice than credit. It is never to be forced. It hangs upon opinion. It depends upon our passions of hope and fear. It comes many times unsought for and often goes away without reason. And when once lost, is hardly to be quite recovered." Nevertheless, in England at least, by then credit seemed to exist everywhere. Contemporaries estimated that 2/3 of all commercial transactions involved credit rather than cash, and by 1782 the Bank of England alone handled bills of exchange worth a total of more than £2 million annually, a stunning extension of the available monetary stock. Borrowing to finance wars rests not only upon the existence of extensive private credit, but also upon a convergence of interest between those who make money and those who make war. For public loans depend on finding both borrowers willing to lend as well as taxpayers willing and able to provide ultimate repayment. In England, tax revenues increased sixfold in the century following 1689. As an alarmed Member of Parliament exclaimed, "Let any gentleman but look into the statute books lying upon our table, he will there see to what a vast bulk, to what a number of volumes our statutes relating to taxes have swelled. It is monstrous. It is even frightful to look into the indexes where for several columns together we see nothing but taxes, taxes, taxes." And yet most MPs who paid the taxes themselves accepted their necessity, and so did the majority of the political nation. By 1783, when the unsuccessful American War came to an end, Great Britain's national debt stood at £245 million, equivalent to more than 20 years' revenue. And yet many of the loans had been contracted at just 3% interest. In the Western way of war, who pays and why is as important as who fights and why. And the ability to organise long-term credit, and therefore the existence of a secure and sophisticated capital market, to fund government borrowing needs in wartime, represented a critical secret weapon of the West. It also served to define which states could adopt the Western way of war, mainly because of the cost of keeping abreast of changing technology and of maintaining the resources to deploy it effectively. Relatively few states proved able to remain in the race for long. Some, like Denmark after 1660, proved too small, or, like Poland after 1667, too fragmented. Others, like Switzerland, chose neutrality. Others still, particularly in regions with less developed economies, directed the energies of their armed forces towards containing and combating internal threats. Conversely, although not all Western states proved able to fight in the Western way, certain other countries did. Japan offers the classic example, thanks to the vital combination of discipline, doctrinal flexibility, and a sophisticated financial structure which, in the 16th century and again in the 19th, permitted both the acquisition of expensive military technology and the equally expensive successive adaptations required to keep abreast, if not ahead, of all rivals. The dominant military tradition. These various developments possessed a significance far beyond the region of their origin, because aggression, the export of violence, played a central role in the rise of the West. For most of the past 2,500 years, military and naval superiority rather than better resources, greater moral rectitude, irresistible commercial acumen, or, until the 19th century, advanced economic organization underpinned Western expansion. This military edge meant that the West seldom suffered successful invasion itself. Armies from Asia and Africa rarely marched into Europe, and many of the exceptions, Xerxes, Hannibal, Attila, the Arabs and the Turks, achieved only limited success. None encompassed the total destruction of their foe. Conversely, Western forces, although numerically inferior, not only defeated the Persian and Carthaginian invaders, but also managed to extirpate the states that sent them. Even the forces of Islam never succeeded in partitioning Europe into spheres of influence in the Western manner. On the other hand, however, time and again a favourable balance of military power critically advanced Western expansion. As Jan Pieterszoon Cohen, one of the founders of Dutch power in Indonesia, observed in 1614, trade in Asia should be conducted and maintained under the protection and with the aid of our own weapons, and those weapons must be wielded with the profits gained by trade. So trade cannot be maintained without war, nor war without trade. By 1650, a generation after these words were written, the West had already achieved military and therefore economic mastery in four separate areas: South, Central and Northeast America, Siberia, some coastal areas of sub-Saharan Africa, and much of the Philippines. In addition, its ships sailed at will all over the world's oceans and, in most of them, managed to regulate and, in some cases, to control the seaborne trade of commercial rivals. In 1500, the states of Western Europe laid claim to less than one-tenth of the world's habitable land, yet by 1775, Europeans, or those of European descent, could lay claim to just over one-third, as well as all its oceans. And by 1914, they had increased that total to almost 85% of the world's habitable land. Even in the 21st century, although the area under their direct control has shrunk dramatically, the ability of Western armed forces to intervene directly and decisively by land and sea, more or less wherever they choose, serves to safeguard the economic interests of its component states and to perpetuate a favourable balance of global power. The military abilities that preserved the West at Salamis, 480 BC, and the Lechlade, AD 955, and expanded its dominance at Tenochtitlan, 1519 to 1521, and Plassey, 1757, for better or worse, still sustain its preponderant role in the world today. The rise of the West is inconceivable without them. Chapter 1. Genesis of the Infantry, 600 to 350 BC. Written by Victor Davis Hansen. At the beginning of the 3rd millennium BC, the success of intensive, irrigated agriculture on the plains of Egypt and the Near East changed the culture of organized war-making, which had previously consisted of small skirmishes between rival groups of nomadic tribesmen. Hydraulic projects, enhanced agronomic techniques, and planned economies at Sumer, Ur, Babylon, Assur, Nimrud, and Egypt created the necessary capital to support armies, logistics, and fortifications. Far more important, sophisticated agriculture instilled an overriding territorial impulse. Growing but stationary populations sought ever more effective ways to defend and to acquire productive farmland. Furthermore, the Near East provided the ideal arena for large, mobile armies. Warm weather during a long growing season coupled with extensive plains broken by accessible rivers. Rugged mountains, swamps, snow, ice and sudden rain, the banes of large-scale and decisive military operations, were all but absent. The agricultural surpluses of the Sumerians, Hittites and Egyptians freed a sizable minority of those peoples from the daily burden of producing food. They could instead fabricate metals for weapons and raise horses to draw war chariots. Yet complex warfare was not merely the consequence of new bronze metals, edged weapons, or increases in the numbers of ponies, dramatic as these new developments were. Just as important was a novel social and economic complexity centering around the palace, an institution that created underlords with specialized military, political, and religious responsibilities, precisely those disciplines prerequisite for war on any large scale. The Hittites, Egyptians, and Assyrians for the first time possessed the capability to muster enormous armies. They were able and willing to extinguish thousands of combatants in a single battle, obliterating entire cultures through the directives and sanction of powerful religious and political palace officials. Thus, the early Assyrian ruler Tiglath-Pileser circa 1100 BC, in near epic terms bragged of his destruction of Hanusa. "Their fighting men I cast down in the midst of the hills like a gust of wind. I cut off their heads like lambs. Their blood I caused to flow in the valleys and on the high places of the mountains. That city I captured, their gods I carried away. I brought out their goods and their possessions, and I burned the city with fire. The three great walls of their city, which were strongly built of burnt brick, and the whole of the city I laid waste, I destroyed, I turned into heaps and ruins, and I sowed crops thereon." Although Bronze Age and later Assyrian and Persian military forces constituted ferocious killing systems, usually unmatched in lethality throughout Greek, Roman, and even modern times, there were inherent limitations to the organization of these military societies. The reliance on the bow and the sling, the horse and the chariot, for example, required some expertise and so the creation of specialized military castes. The Near Eastern propensity for the construction and destruction of extensive fortifications also depleted resources to an astonishing degree. The familiar biblical account of Joshua's destruction of Jericho provides some idea of the potential for carnage. "The people shouted with a great shout, and the wall fell down flat, so that the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city, and they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, both young and old, and ox and sheep, and ass with the edge of the sword." Most important, Bronze Age societies were authoritarian and very narrowly hierarchical. The power to initiate, to manage, and to terminate wars lay in the hands of only the very privileged few. Often a single ruler might claim to have enslaved thousands. The death of a strong man, subsequent fights over his royal succession, feuds between rival dynasts, could all provoke the mobilization and annihilation or enslavement of thousands, even when few economic or social advantages resulted for the majority of the combatants. In similar fashion, the loss or removal of those select few with the expertise and authority to conduct wars, often necessary wars, might severely curtail the military potential of an entire society and thus call into question its survival. No wonder that the capture, torture, and execution of a rival potentate, followed by the subsequent destruction of his fortress, appear so frequently in the dynastic annals, hieroglyphs, and stone reliefs of the Near East. There were no common protocols of war in the ancient Near East that might have limited war to the combatants themselves and so moderated the destructive tendencies of these regimes. Yeomen of the Greek polis. Warfare underwent a second transformation in Greece, again as a consequence of evolving agricultural practice. In the 2nd and 3rd millennia BC, farming in Greece remained a bureaucratic enterprise along Near Eastern lines. Late Mycenaean society on the Greek mainland, 1600 to 1200 BC, was largely analogous to other Mediterranean and Asian palace monarchies, therefore offering very little chance for military experimentation, much less the dissemination of military planning and responsibility beyond the very few. But once warfare was liberated, if we dare use that word in a context of organized slaughter, from centralized palatial control to the power of individuals, battle was left to evolve in a manner previously unknown. For the origins of Western warfare, for the genesis of sophisticated metallurgy and technology, superior discipline, ingenuity in challenge and response, and the creation of a broad, shared military tradition among the majority of the population, one should look to the collapse of the Mycenaean palaces on the Greek mainland and the ensuing Dark Ages, 1100 to 800 BC. There arose in the 8th century BC communities of roughly equal property owners. The emerging culture of the Greek polis, city-state. With the polis began Western military practice as we now recognize it. A practice at its birth largely at odds with moral fervor, immune from priestly religious interference, and centered around decisive confrontation in pitched battle rather than the reliance on sheer numbers or the expertise of engineers and logisticians. Early on, the Greeks quite chauvinistically recognized that their city-state constituted a unique institution, in sharp contrast to the palace-based cultures of past ages. The early Greek poet Phocylides confidently wrote, "A small polis on a headland is superior to senseless Nineveh if its affairs are conducted in an orderly fashion." Another 6th century BC poet, Alcaeus, sounded a similar populist theme. "Not finely roofed houses, nor the stones of well-built walls, nor even canals or dockyards make the polis, but rather men of the type able to meet the challenge at hand." The key to the Greek cultural renaissance of the 8th and 7th centuries BC, to the move from the collective towards the individual, lay in a radical change in agricultural production and, concurrently, in the manner of waging war. Under the pressure of population growth, the Greeks built their city-states on family-operated, privately-owned farms, where intensive practices ensured food surpluses and yet allowed agricultural bounty to be free from bureaucratic interference at the top. In short, there was now to be no top. Instead, to protect and empower this new group of rising farmers, there arose broad-based oligarchies and a cultural ethos of property egalitarianism among a privileged yeomanry. Farmers formed the voting citizenry of more than 1,000 small city-states throughout the Greek-speaking world. In this climate of agrarianism appeared the hoplite fighter or heavy infantryman. The 4th century BC historian Xenophon stressed in his Economicus just this connection between yeomanry and group fighting in the phalanx. Farming teaches one to help others. So too, in fighting one's enemies, just as in working the earth, it is necessary to have the help of other people. Small farmers alone, not leisured aristocrats, not hereditary monarchs, not hired thugs or cabals, in most regions of Greece in the 7th and 6th centuries BC, increasingly made the laws, grew the food, and fought the landed wars of their cities. For 2 centuries, 700 to 500 BC, Greek warfare remained somewhat static, in the sense that hoplite battle followed extensive agrarian custom and even contrived military protocol, sometimes by limiting an entire conflict to a single afternoon's collision between columns of spearmen encased in bronze. When conflict arose, almost exclusively before the 5th century BC, over disputed, often marginal, border territory, city-states agreed to decide the issue through a sudden collision of armoured columns. Each warrior landowner purchased his own armour, which could weigh a punishing 50 pounds of wood and metal, greaves, bronze shin protectors, helmet, concave round shield, breastplate, double-pointed spear, and short secondary sword. Singly and in isolation, the Greek agrarian hoplite proved a plodding, helpless target. He could easily be outmaneuvered. He could be cut off, especially if he ventured onto rough terrain in mountain passes, or, worse, became caught in the open by horsemen or lightly clad missile troops. In a sense, therefore, the infantryman was intrinsically ill-suited to the natural relief and terrain of Greece. But most Greek farmers had little intention of fighting either alone or far away from their favoured flat cropland, much less against mounted magnificos or in the hills against their clear social inferiors, the landless skirmishers. Instead, arrayed in the packed ranks of the phalanx, they chose agricultural warfare on their own predominantly agrarian terms. Farmers fighting farmers on farmland over farmland. The accumulation of raised shields across the armoured columns, the protruding spears of the first three ranks, made the serried files of the phalanx invincible to either light-armed or mounted attack. "It was a sight at once awesome and terrifying," remarks the 1st century AD biographer Plutarch of the Spartan phalanx, drawing his description from centuries-old sources, as they marched in step to the pipe, leaving no gap in their line of battle, and with no confusion in their hearts, calmly and cheerfully advancing into danger. Once Greek warfare was centred around hoplite battle, both the more affluent horsemen and the impoverished light-armed troops were relegated to secondary status on the battlefield. The growing yeoman class of independent property owners had crafted fighting to reflect their own political and economic agenda. If the countryside was to be a patchwork of roughly similar farms worked by leather-clad yeomen, so too the phalanx was an analogous grid of identically armoured fighters. Just as intensive agriculture in Greece of the polis had swallowed the horse's domain of open-range land, so too the hoplite now displaced the mounted fighter. Xenophon reflected the dominant hoplite ideology of the 7th to 5th centuries BC when he scoffed that "only the weakest in strength and the least eager for glory mounted horses." No one, Xenophon on another occasion reminded his 10,000 mercenary hoplites, has ever lost his life in battle from the bite or kick of a horse, but it is men who do whatever is done in battle. In a very real sense, for 1,000 years to come, in Western warfare, the cavalry grandee was the spiritual ancillary to the infantry. When Greek property owners voted to march beyond their borders to fight, hamlets and kin groups quickly mustered into the ranks of the city-state's phalanx by tribe and locale. The trek over the mountains, the fight, and the return home usually required no more than a three-day excursion. Until the 5th century BC, little attention was given to sophisticated logistics. Fighting itself was equally economical. After the attackers provoked the enemy to march out, often by cutting down a few fruit trees and vines, both sides squared off. Battle leader is a better term than general for an officer who was posted in the front rank with responsibility only to lead by example and thus to fight or to die in front of his men. The poet Archilochus remarked in the 7th century BC, "I don't like the towering captain with legs astride, one who swaggers in his lovelocks and clean shaves beneath his chin. Give me instead a man short and squarely set upon his legs, a man full of heart, not to be shaken from the place he plants his feet." After such a commander gave a brief harangue, and the seer sanctioned the pre-battle sacrifice of a ram or goat in front of the phalanx, the two columns would collide. In the words of the poet Tertius, "toe to toe, shield against shield, hard driven, crest against crest, and helmet on helmet." The key in this peculiar fighting was for the farmer hoplite to make some gap in the enemy's line. Such a disruption would allow his armoured comrades to be pushed on through behind him, sowing disorder within the belligerent's interior, thus creating panic among the mass of enemy hoplites who could not hear and scarcely see. Ancient authors emphasise the dust, the confusion, and the gore of the phalanx melee, and there is good reason to agree that a Greek battle of this era was a horrific scene, not an ordered pushing match between squared columns. Indeed, at the Battle of Delium in 424 BC, during the Peloponnesian War, Thucydides says that the Athenians became confused in their encirclement, mistook, and thus killed one another. Later in Sicily, They were thrown into disorder until they finally came into collision with each other in many places on the field, friends with friends, citizens with citizens, and not only terrified one another, but even began fighting and could be separated only with difficulty. Solidarity and discipline. In the tumult of the hoplite battlefield, tactics and strategy meant little. Solidarity and discipline were everything. Fighting aimed to eliminate the need for reserves, articulation, stratagems, and manoeuvre. Even in the growth of hoplite armies in the 4th century BC, Xenophon could still rightly remark that tactics form only a small part of army command. Instead, in the heyday of the hoplite, an agrarian code prevailed that frowned on ruse or even individual heroics outside the ranks of the phalanx. Under this system of open battle before the Peloponnesian War, 431 to 404 BC, internecine fighting could be very frequent among the Greek city-states, but their defence expenditures probably remained small. Arms were roughly the same in all camps, nearly uniform and thus recyclable, as well as both durable and repairable. No permanent, rarefied officer corps existed. Battle fatalities in a single pitched battle due to heavy armour were kept to around 10% of the respective armies, as extensive pursuit was impracticable and often discouraged. Military training and time lost to campaigning were similarly negligible. Pay, protracted sieges, and the extensive fortifications characteristic of later Greek warfare were still sporadic. Historians sometimes seem reluctant to appreciate the consciously agrarian nature of this fighting, the astonishing degree to which farming protocol and the rural sociology of the polis defined warfare across the variegated landscape of the emerging Greek communities. Nevertheless, the Greeks themselves continually reinforced these practices through their literature, philosophy, vase painting, sculpture, and public commemoration, all incessantly stressing the hoplite's bravery and cohesion, glorifying his arms and armour, and exalting his final battle sacrifice before the eyes of friends and family, all to the implicit diminution of the missile men, the light-armed, and even the wealthier horsemen. These warriors did not necessarily share the hoplite's peculiar notions of agrarian exclusivity. They were not committed, as the hoplite was, to preserving the existing structures of property ownership, landed control of voting councils and assemblies, and reliance on local produce. Rather than fight for all that, the poor and the elite preferred missile weaponry and horses, ambush and pursuit, skirmishing and siegecraft, where military prowess was not simplistically predicated on an hour's exhibition of muscular strength and steely nerve. But these non-hoplites formed an unpopular minority. In the 1st century AD, the geographer Strabo claimed he had seen an inscription on an ancient pillar that forbade missiles altogether in early Greek warfare. Of his fatal wounding by a rare arrow, a Spartan hoplite made the famous complaint that death was of no concern, except that it was caused by a cowardly archer. The Greeks of the past, wrote the historian Polybius nostalgically in the 2nd century BC, did not even choose to defeat their adversaries through deceit, thinking instead that there was nothing glorious or even secure in military successes unless one side killed the enemy drawn up in open battle. Therefore, there was an agreement not to employ unseen weapons or missiles against one another. But they decided that only hand-to-hand fighting in massed column was the true arbiter of events. For that very reason, they made public announcements to each other about wars and battles in advance, when they would decide to enter them, and even concerning the places where they were to meet and draw up their lines. In the classic age of hoplite battle, 700 to 431 BC, the overall material prosperity and steady cultural evolution of the Greek city-states stemmed in large parts from the careful restrictions on fighting. Philosophers sought no utopian and hence doomed effort to end warfare. Rather, the city-states crafted rituals that allowed for frequent, inevitable conflict and battlefield heroics, all without fatal costs to the infrastructure of Greek society, which in the first 2 to 3 centuries of the polis remained emphatically agrarian. In sum, the culture of the Greek polis, in contrast to the ancient Near East, flourished precisely because organized killing and defense expenditure remained within reasonable limits. The historian Thucydides, writing at the end of the 5th century BC, remarked of earlier times, "There was no war by land, at least not by which any hegemony was acquired. There were many border contests, but of foreign expeditions designed for conquest, there were none among the Greeks. Indeed, no subject city-states fell under the control of the great city-states. Thus, these Greek communities did not unite as equals for allied expeditions. Instead, fighting at this time consisted merely of local warring between rival neighbors." The 5th century BC changed all that. East meets West. Knowledge about Greek warfare before the Persian Wars, 490 and 480 to 478 BC, is sketchy. It must be pieced together from lyric and elegiac poetry, later speculation of historians, philosophers, and antiquarians, and the physical remains of arms and armour. In contrast, the infantry and naval fighting of the 5th and 4th centuries BC are well documented in the great histories of Herodotus, Thucydides, and Xenophon. And it is from Herodotus' history, for example, that the Persian invasions appear momentous, unlike anything in the past Greek experience of the prior 2 centuries. A preliminary Persian probe of 490 BC, under an expansion-minded King Darius I, was decisively checked by the Athenians at Marathon, where the Persians unwisely staked the outcome on a single infantry clash upon the enclosed Attic seaside plain. The Greeks' victory there set a pattern of east-west confrontation that remained virtually unaltered for the next 3 centuries. If at any time, at any locale, or in any number, Eastern infantry were foolish enough to charge the disciplined ranks of Western armoured pikemen, they inevitably crumbled. And yet, despite the later glorification and exaltation of the heroic Marathon men in Athenian literature, their victory merely postponed the Eastern onslaught for a decade. When the Persians returned in 480 BC under Darius' son and heir Xerxes, the military situation was entirely altered, the challenge unique, the invaders far more sophisticated and better prepared. As the contemporary dramatist Aeschylus put it, the Easterners sought no single pitched battle, but rather they now planned to yoke Hellas in servitude. Xerxes' assault on Greece in 480 BC was no expeditionary brigade, but a veritable travelling polyglot city of thousands, slowly inching its way southward into Greece, gobbling up city-states by capitulation or accommodation as it progressed. Accompanied by a prodigious fleet, the Persians had no intention of fighting a single infantry battle. Indeed, they scoffed at the so-called laws of the Greeks which restricted Hellenic warfare to a single land battle. "These Greeks," mused Mardonius, the Persian general, "are accustomed to wage their wars amongst each other in the most senseless way, for as soon as they declare war on each other, they seek out the fairest and most level ground, and then go down there to do battle on it. Consequently, even the winner leaves with extreme losses. I need not mention the conquered, since they are annihilated. Clearly, since they all speak Greek, they should rather exchange heralds and negotiators and thereby settle differences by any means rather than battle." The Persians, by contrast, came bent on outright conquest, and their challenge was clear to the Greek city-states: numbers, sailors, tactics, fortification, evacuation, trickery, subterfuge, and generalship were all needed, and quickly. Overnight, they entered the mainstream practice of Greek warfare. An advance Spartan contingent, supported by Thespians and Thebans, was mowed down in glorious annihilation defending the high frontier pass up north at Thermopylae, 480 BC. Its king, Leonidas, decapitated, his head impaled on a pole. An Athenian-led fleet shadowed the approaching eastern ships as Xerxes made his way through central Greece and on into a deserted Athens. In this new world of total war, some Greeks were forced not merely to redefine their traditional way of fighting, but to change their concept of the city-state itself. Not a mere physical entity of buildings, an acropolis, and the surrounding fields of its farmers, the polis, the city-state, was, after all, people. People were all that mattered. The native-born residents of all classes who could be saved through evacuation to return as avengers on either land or sea. Landed conservatives at Athens calling on farmers for a single hoplite conflict of the old style to protect the city proper and the agrarian prestige of the countryside were not merely misguided, but nearly lunatic as well. The Athenians therefore left their polis to the invader's torch, evacuating to nearby free territory, relying on the wooden walls of their ships to defeat the Persians off the adjacent island of Salamis. Whatever the later complaints of reactionary Athenian philosophers that sea power was unheroic, the anti-democrat Plato, a century after Salamis, felt the Athenian victory there had made Greeks worse as a people. All Greeks knew that the destruction of most of Xerxes' armada at Salamis had ruined the morale of the Persians and set the stage for a final fight at Plataea the next spring. Suddenly, without their fleet, the haughty Persian invaders in the spring of 479 BC found themselves cut off. They were in an increasingly untenable position, as hoplites from all over central and southern Greece flocked to form a grand army of last resistance near the small village of Plataea on the Athenian-Boeotian border. Spartan discipline and, in the words of the playwright Aeschylus, the power of the Dorian spear that poured blood in unmeasurable sacrifice, backed by Athenian enthusiasm and the sheer mass of Greek infantry. Never again would classical Greece field a force approaching 70,000 combatants. Broke the Persian army, and then slaughtered the majority of the fleeing survivors. Aftermath of the Persian Wars. In the aftermath of the Persian invasion and defeat, as is common after any great social and cultural upheaval, a conscious return to normality occurred in Greek warfare. Once more, we hear for a time of a series of infantry wars over borders among the city-states decided in the old way. Traditional one-hour standoffs at the battles of Dipia, 471 BC, Tanagra and Oinophyta, 457 BC, and Coronea, 447 BC. But stones were thrown into the hoplite pond by the Persian experience, as the multifarious lessons of the victories over Xerxes rippled slowly throughout Greek city-states. Chief among the new realities were two phenomena that helped explain the sharp break with the polis warfare of the past. First, the victories at Salamis and Plataea left two city-states, Sparta and Athens, alone prestigious and preeminent. Both were unusually powerful, atypical and antithetical Greek city-states, which could afford to transcend the old rules of agrarian warfare. Supported by nearly 200,000 helots or indentured servants who worked the farms of Messenia and Laconia, the Spartans fielded professional hoplites, year-round infantry not subject to the normal restrictions that free agriculture placed on yeomanry in infantry battle. The Spartan king, Agesilaus, once asked his allied Peloponnesian army to stand up by profession, potters, smiths, carpenters, builders, and all the others. At last, only the minority of his Spartiates remained seated. Those few who did nothing other than make war. You see, men, how many more soldiers we send out to fight than you do, Agesilaus scoffed. Plutarch records that the Spartans could boast, not by caring for the fields, but rather by caring for ourselves did we come to own those fields. Nor were the increasingly democratic Athenians comfortable to carry on simply with the traditional artificial collision between oligarchical armoured farmers. In the wake of the Persian withdrawal, 479 BC, Athens' fleet continued to increase. Nurtured on the tribute of vassal states in the Aegean, Athenian triremes were not mothballed, but became instead a benign police force of sorts for its Greek subject allies overseas. Like the Spartans, Imperial Athens too saw little need to limit warfare to a single summer afternoon, or indeed, given the success of its evacuation before Xerxes and subsequent naval response, to risk at all its infantry in defence of the farmland of Attica. Second, the success of the non-hoplite forces in the Persian Wars left a marked impression on the Greeks. Ships, light-armed troops and cavalry had been present in a variety of theatres and terrains, underscoring how vulnerable and how inadequate the hoplite phalanx might become before any adversary who was, wisely, unwilling to face it in a single pitched battle. The problem for the Greek polis was not merely fielding such diverse contingents, but rather coping with the inevitable social challenges that the use of such forces posed. Give rowers, skirmishers, or cavalry military importance and the old agrarian exclusivity of the polis, the very fabric and ideology of the Greek city-state, was compromised. Farmers with heavy armour and spear no longer warranted privileged social and political status. As Aristotle once observed in his Politics, in a polis, the ones who fight have the supreme power, and those who possess the armament are the citizens. The ensuing Peloponnesian War between Athens and Sparta was not decided in an afternoon, nor even in the space of a summer or two. The killing dragged on for 27 years. It is easy to see why. Abandoning its countryside to Spartan invaders, Athens refused pitched battle with the crack hoplites of Sparta. Of the hoplite farmers who were obliged to trek into the city walls, Thucydides movingly remarked, "Most Athenians still lived on their farms with their families and households, and were consequently not at all inclined to move now, especially as they had only just restored their establishments after the Persian invasion. Deep was their discontent and unhappiness at leaving behind their homes." Instead, Athens, once besieged, increasingly imported food and material into its port at Piraeus, all the while sending out its magnificent fleet to stabilize its maritime empire and to prevent Peloponnesian infiltrations. Sparta, for its part, found the old strategy of ravaging cropland discomfortingly ineffective. Its hoplites in Attica could neither draw the Athenian army out nor reduce the city economically. Consequently, both belligerents turned to a variety of secondary theatres throughout the Aegean world and Asia Minor. In these latter proxy wars between 421 and 404 BC, Athens ironically used its hoplites in combined maritime operations, whereas Sparta and its allies in time developed a competent fleet. During the entire course of the Peloponnesian War, there were not more than three or four battles of the old style. Mercenaries, light-armed skirmishers, sailors, and siege engineers filled the void. All were expensive and disastrously for both sides. All apparently were incapable in themselves of ending an engagement decisively through the destruction or humiliation of an enemy's forces in the field. Strategy became prominent as the Athenians made inconsequential probes into Spartan territory and, most tragically, lost an expedition of 40,000 men 1,000 miles distant in repeated defeats before Syracuse in Sicily, 415 to 413 BC. Thucydides summarized that novel Greek experience of outright military extermination. He wrote, The Athenians were beaten in all areas and altogether. All that they suffered was great. They were annihilated, as the saying goes, with a total annihilation. Their fleet, their army, everything was annihilated, and few out of many returned home. Sparta, for its part, more pragmatically, systematically garrisoned Attica to encourage desertions and local disruptions in commerce, all the while applying steady pressure to prise away tribute-paying Athenian allies in the Aegean, the lifeblood of the city's capital and military reserves. No wonder that, after nearly three decades, at the war's end in 404 BC, Athens was left bankrupt, exhausted, and demoralized. But Sparta and its allies were in no position to assume lasting hegemony of Greece. In the detritus of the Peloponnesian War, agrarian fighting of the old polis was supplemented as warfare now meant expansion of conflict onto a variety of costly and deadly new horizons. Into the 4th century. Fondness for the collision of infantry columns was not entirely forgotten in the next century. Despite attempts by modern scholars to detect tactical evolution in 4th century BC hoplite phalanxes, reserves, feints, maneuver, clashes between columns in themselves really had changed little, as the reactionary battles between hoplite dinosaurs at Nemea, 394 BC, Coronea, 394 BC, Leuctra, 371 BC, and Mantinea, 362 BC, attest. Indeed, even a hoplite at Leuctra, supposedly the most revolutionary of 4th century BC battles, would have felt at home in armament, fighting practice and spirit among the ranks of his ancestors battling 300 years earlier at Hycaea, 669 BC. And of the horrific, old-style struggle between Spartan and Theban hoplites at the Second Battle of Coronea, the contemporary witness Xenophon dryly concluded of its predictability. They collided, pushed, fought, killed, and died. What was transformed, and transformed very radically, was not battle, but war. Fighting now consisted of skirmishing, garrisoning high passes, mercenary raiding, marine assaults, sieges, and counter-fortifications. Plunder and the search for captives reflected new economic realities, as war came to be a source of state capital, a line item on state budgets. And this confusion was as it should be. For once Greece re-entered the main fabric of Mediterranean history in the 5th and 4th centuries BC, its unique institution, the city-state, dominated by an exclusive trinity, smallholder food producer, hoplite infantryman, and maker of laws, was shown to be a closed system. It had no ability to assimilate as citizens those with non-landed wealth, gifted foreigners, or those who fought outside the agrarian phalanx. The genie was now out of the bottle. Western warfare, created as a protective mechanism for their agrarian city-state, had entered a new, far more sophisticated, far more lethal phase, one divorced from social constraint, but still fueled by the Greek genius for innovation and response. Chapter 2. From Phalanx to Legion, 350 to 250 BC. Written by Victor Davis Hanson. The waning Greek city-states attempted valiantly, but more often tragically, to incorporate new methods of fighting, even though they were antithetical to the old amateur hoplite battle and the traditional etiquette of agrarian warfare. Nostalgia about the old ways continued, but political leaders were forced to confront the new military realities. The orator Demosthenes warned his 4th century BC audience of complacent Athenians by saying, "Nothing has been more revolutionized and improved than the art of war." I know that in the old times, he continued, the Spartans, like everyone else, would devote 4 or 5 months in the summer to invading and ravaging the enemy's territory with hoplites and citizen militia, and then would go home again. And they were so old-fashioned, or such good citizens, that they never used money to buy advantage from anyone, but their fighting was fair and open. Social status was now largely divorced from the battlefield. Wealthy, middling, and poor Greeks could all ride horses, throw javelins, or wield spears, either as hired killers or as reluctant militiamen. The exclusive equation of farmer and infantryman disappeared. Xenophon complained in his Ways and Means that at Athens the phalanx was losing esteem by recruiting the city's resident aliens into the ranks of the infantry. He advised, the polis also would be helped if our citizens served alongside one another and no longer found themselves mixed together with Lydians, Phrygians, Syrians and barbarians of every type who form a large portion of our resident alien population. The chief problem in this expansive world of 4th century BC Greek warfare was its cost. Torsion catapults, mercenary skirmishers, permanent navvies, skilled archers, slingers and stone throwers, the ability to confront all sorts of military challenges at any time, all required capital. Yet, paradoxically, the move towards year-round confrontation in all theatres of the Mediterranean also ensured that the vital sources of Greek military revenue, commerce, agriculture, and calm in the countryside, would suffer continual disruption. War becomes too expensive. Many city-states then found themselves in a dilemma. They could neither endure provocation and plundering of their territory nor afford the necessary permanent force to ensure tranquility. Xenophon saw that the complex warfare between the squabbling city-states had become too expensive for most polis treasuries, and so belligerently sometimes demanded a pragmatic rather than a heroic posture. He stated, "Someone might ask me that even if a polis is wronged, should she then remain at peace with the aggressor? No, of course not. But I do say that we should have better luck against an enemy if we first of all provoke no one by doing wrong ourselves." Few hoplite militias after the indecisive battle of Manintaia, 362 BC between Thebes and Sparta, fought decisive pitched engagements. And even then, phalanx collision no longer determined the outcome of wars. Indeed, the last hoplite standoff between the Spartans and the Thebans at Manintaia solved nothing. Xenophon claimed in the last pages of his History of Greece that after the battle, neither side turned out to be any better off, to have any additional territory, any additional polis, or any more influence. In fact, even more confusion and disorder occurred in Greece after the battle than before. After all, once stripped of its surrounding and protective agrarian protocol, by itself the phalanx was tactically problematic, a clumsy instrument of pursuit poorly adapted to destroy the increasingly multifarious forces in the field. If it could no longer achieve decisive results, other forces, hired by the state, could. So the old set-piece battle was replaced by the daring and braggadocio of mercenary captains and itinerant condottieri, buccaneers who ignored the protocol of the old Greek city-states. Isocrates, a 4th century BC Athenian orator, complained that his compatriots no longer selected military commanders from among their amateur politicians, but turned instead to shady professionals. The men whose advice we follow in areas of the greatest importance, we do not elect to be our generals, as if we distrusted their intelligence. But those whose advice no one would want either for his own business or for that of the polis, these we now send into the field with unchecked authority. Employing alliance, counter-alliance, subterfuge and plotting, the major players, Athens, Sparta, Thebes, Argos, Corinth, Thessaly and Sicily used all forces at their disposal to maintain an exhausting but nevertheless rough balance of power for the first half of the 4th century BC, all while apprehensively eyeing the new threat of Macedon to the north. The phalanx reinvented. Unfortunately for the Greek city-states, King Philip II of Macedon was no mere hoplite battle leader of the old style. Much less was he simply a crafty, underpowered brigand who could carve out or extort a few years' hegemony over Greek communities. Instead, meticulously, insidiously, for more than 20 years, 359 to 338 BC, Philip crafted a grand new army supplied, led, and organized quite differently from anything in past Greek practice. To his phalanx of grim, professional foot companions, pegetarii, the biggest and strongest of all the Macedonians according to a contemporary commentary, Philip added the companion cavalry, hetairi, an elite body of aristocratic horsemen, heavily armoured on strong mounts. Another contingent of infantry with perhaps less armour, the shield-bearers, hippaspists, occupied the centre of the Macedonian line beside the phalanx. The hippaspists were usually the first infantry forces to follow behind the cavalry onslaught, thereby providing a crucial link between the initial mounted attack and the subsequent follow-up by the phalanx proper. Professional corps of light infantry, slingers, archers, and javelin men rounded out the composite army group, supplying both preliminary bombardment and crucial reserve support. These Macedonian contingents were not a fragmentation of forces, but rather a diversification and sophistication in arms, a symphony, not a cacophony, of professionally equipped men. The phalanx was thoroughly rehabilitated by Philip, and it gained fresh importance, but with him, the evolution away from its agrarian roots accelerated. The 4th century BC Athenian general Iphicrates had foreseen these multifaceted military innovations when, in typically Greek fashion, he compared the new army to a human organism, light-armed troops as hands, the cavalry as feet, the infantry phalanx proper as chest and breastplate, and the general as head. Philip's contribution to the history of Western warfare was as much organizational as tactical. At first, the equipment and tactics of his Macedonian phalanx did not differ considerably from the traditional hoplite columns of the Greek city-states. The spear, Sarissa, for example, was retained, but it was lengthened from 8 to nearly 14 feet. It now required both hands for adequate control and handling. The round shield shrank, as greaves, most breastplates, and heavy headgear were replaced with leather or composite materials, or abandoned altogether. But the central idea of the fighting mass remained predominant. Writing in the Roman era, the military theorist Onosander remarked of the Macedonian phalanx that the advancing formations appear more dangerous through the splendour of their equipment, and that terrible sight frightens the very souls of the enemy. Indeed, integrated with and protected by such variegated forces, Philip's phalanx of pikemen was both more lethal and more versatile than the traditional hoplite columns. Now with longer spears, the first five, not merely the initial three, ranks could strike at the enemy. The 2nd century BC Greek historian Polybius knew that infantry who faced such a storm of spears might have as many as 10 iron points concentrated on each man. Polybius concluded that nothing can stand up to the phalanx. The Roman by himself, with his sword, can neither slash down nor break through the 10 spears that all at once press against him. The men of the Macedonian phalanx, after all, could turn their attention exclusively to thrusting their dreadful spears without the cumbersome weight of the old hoplite panoply, or the need to protect with an enormous shield their immediate comrades on the right. A fence, pikes, and motion forward now counted for everything. Defence, large shields, and worry over covering neighbours meant little. The Macedonians aimed at advance and annexation, not the preservation of their borders. Used with great precision and power, the new Macedonian phalanx usually delivered a knockout blow once the target had been sighted and then left vulnerable by the work of cavalry and ancillary contingents. Hammer-like cavalry attacks battered the enemy back onto the clumsy, mile-long anvil of the spear-bristling phalanx, although this infantry mass, as the Greek historian Polybius explained, always had to be careful to stay on clear ground, free of ditches, ravines, trees, ridges and watercourses, all of which can stop and break up such a formation. Such coordination between infantry and horsemen was an entirely new development in the history of Western warfare, far beyond the tactical capacity or vision of even the most militarily innovative 4th century BC Greeks. Macedonian mastery. Philip also brought to Western warfare a new ideology of battle. True, the actual stand-up fighting still involved frontal assaults and so continued to be every bit as gallant as in the old Greek phalanxes of the past. The running collision of massed infantry, the spear tip to the face of the enemy, were still the preferred creed of any Macedonian phalangite who lined up in column. But war-making had become much more than personal courage, nerve, and physical strength. Nor did the grim-faced Macedonians kill just to win borderlands. Rather, battle was designed predominantly as an instrument of ambitious state policy. Philip's destructive mechanism for conquest and annexation was a radical source of social unrest and cultural upheaval. Not a conservative Greek institution to preserve the existing agrarian community. His men, too, were a completely different breed from the hoplites of the past. In his comedy Philip, the playwright Nesimachus, circa 350 BC, makes his characteristic Macedonian phalangites boast, "Do you know against what type of men you'll have to fight? We dine on sharpened swords and drink down blazing torches as our wine. Then for dessert they bring us broken Cretan darts and splintered pike shafts. Our pillows are shields and breastplates, and beside our feet lie bows and slings. We crown ourselves with catapult garlands." Philip's known hostility towards independent city-states, composed of yeoman hoplites, explains his exaggerated portrayal in the conservative 4th century BC oratory of the Greek polis. Demosthenes described him as a limping, one-eyed monster, so fond of danger that in order to make his empire greater, he has been wounded in every part of his body whilst fighting his enemies. A terrible superman who would fight at any time, in any and all manners. Demosthenes warned the Athenians, "You hear that Philip marches unchecked, not because he leads a phalanx of hoplites, but rather because he is accompanied by skirmishers, cavalry, archers, mercenaries, and similar troops. When relying on these forces, he attacks a people that is at odds with itself, and when, through distrust, no one goes forth to fight for his country, he next brings up his artillery and lays siege. I need hardly tell you that Philip makes no difference between summer and winter, and has no season set apart for inaction." At Chaeronea, 338 BC, Philip and his 18-year-old son Alexander shattered the phalanx of the Thebans and Athenians, and with it they broke the national resistance of Greece. Beware of attributing the causes of that watershed victory to superior Macedonian technology, skill, or tactical innovation alone. It was the panic and collapse of the advancing, wild-eyed Athenians on the left that fatally weakened the cohesion of the Greek line. The Athenian infantry nearly swarmed through the ranks of the Macedonians as their allied Thebans across the plain on the right wing held out stubbornly against attack of the young mounted Alexander. In contrast, Macedonian discipline, superb integration of horse and infantrymen, complete battlefield command and control of all contingents, rather than the lengths of their pikes or Philip's feigned withdrawal, explain the Northerners' triumph. In the battle's aftermath, the Thebans lay annihilated on the field. The elite corps, their sacred band of 150 pairs of homosexual lovers, had gone down like some magnificent wounded stag, later to be interred under the stone lion which still stands beside the modern roadway. Of the slain Athenians at Chaeronea, the last generation of free hoplite infantry, a poignant epitaph recorded, "Time, the all-surveying deity of all kinds of affairs, be a messenger to all men of our sufferings. How striving to save the sacred land of Greece, we died on the famed plains of Boeotia." West meets East. From the experience of the battles of Marathon and Plataea, the Greeks had known that Persia was vulnerable. In 401 BC, the gallant 10,000, a Greek mercenary force hired by Cyrus II to reclaim the throne of Persia, discovered the same, though forced to retreat after the death of their employer at the Battle of Cunaxa. The Spartans, sent to drive the Persians out of Asia Minor in the 390s BC, found that Greek infantry could experience little difficulty in breaking apart any infantry corps the Persians might field. Ironically, the chief worry for a Greek expeditionary army in the east was facing the ubiquitous Persian-bought mercenary hoplites from their own country. For example, on his return from a visit to Asia, 367 BC, Antiochus, the ambassador of a Greek city-state, scoffed that he had seen the Persian kings, bakers, cooks, wine pourers, and doorkeepers in vast numbers, but as for men of the type who could fight with Greeks, he had looked carefully, but could not find any. Conquest in the East, then, had been in the mind of some Greeks for generations. After all, the enormous wealth of the Persian Empire was especially tempting to Greek politicians given their own growing economic difficulties and the accelerating erosion of imperial control across the Aegean in Asia. But the trick had always been to give up the old idea of a hoplite militia, devising in its place a logistical system and a loyal, unified army from all Greek city-states, a social and military amalgam that could be supplied over the great distances whilst confronting a variety of enemy troops on any terrain. For just that reason, the 4th century BC Spartan king Agesilaus was supposed to have deplored the continual infighting of the Greeks while their enemy, the Persians, remained unattacked. "If we are to continue to destroy those Greeks we find at fault, we had better be careful that we still have enough men to conquer the barbarians." After the assassination of Philip, 336 BC, the 20-year-old Alexander began his deceased father's planned Persian invasion with a victory at the Granicus River near the Hellespont, 334 BC. No typical Alexandrian battle exists. No exact blueprint explains the young general's tactical victories. But in his first savage onslaught at the Granicus, Alexander established a pattern that was to distinguish his next three major battle triumphs at Issus, 333 BC, Gaugamela, 331 BC, and the Hydaspes, 326 BC. The blueprint consisted of 1. Brilliant adaptation to local, often unfavourable terrain. All his battles were fought on or near rivers. 2. Generalship, by several frightful examples of personal, always nearly fatal, courage at the head of the companion cavalry. 3. Stunning cavalry charges focused on a concentrated spot in the enemy line that aimed to turn the dazed enemy onto the spears of the advancing phalanx. 4. The assignment of specialized units for initial feints or to fill in sudden trouble spots. And 5. The subsequent pursuit or destruction of enemy forces in the field, reflecting Alexander's impulse to eliminate, not merely to defeat, hostile armies. At the Granicus, for example, Alexander shrugged off the ostensible disadvantage in crossing the swollen stream once he discovered that the Persians had unwisely placed light cavalry in front of their Greek mercenary phalanx. He focused on the left centre of their line for his main strike. To prevent the enemy from massing at just that point of attack, Alexander dispatched an initial, sacrificial Macedonian cavalry charge further to the left of the Persian line, where the enemy instinctively, mistakenly, sent reinforcements. Suddenly, Alexander himself emerged out of the Granicus, driving on an oblique onslaught of heavy horsemen. The enemy cavalry reeled, then slowly gave way in the ferocious melee. Plutarch relates that in the hand-to-hand fighting, Alexander nearly perished, his gaudy shield and white plume drawing the attention of numerous missiles, a javelin caught in his breastplate, a battle axe nearly cleaved his helmet. Immediately the Macedonian phalanx and hippastists came on, ploughing into the water, clambering up the banks, demolishing, as pike-carrying columns historically do, the confused enemy cavalry. With the Persian cavalry front shattered, the enemy Greek phalanx at the rear was quickly encircled by the left and right wing of the victorious Macedonian horse. It only remained to channel the doomed Hellenic mercenaries into the advancing infantry. The entire mass of hired Greeks either perished or surrendered. Fewer than 200 Macedonians fell, perhaps 10,000 Persians and Greek mercenaries died. No wonder Alexander's Macedonians, nobles, peasants, and thugs alike, would follow a commander like this deep into the rich interior of Asia. Yet dramatic as these battlefield masterpieces were, decisive as his battle strategy of seeking out enemy forces rather than mere territory was, major pitched confrontation still totaled no more than a week's work out of nearly 3,600 days of near-constant campaigning. And so it is wise to remember as well the less heralded sieges, marches, and skirmishes, operations that were equally a part of the Macedonians' remarkable decade-long destruction of Asian civilization. The personal courage of Alexander, including his magnificent, nearly suicidal, dives into the enemy line, is rather deceptive. Far from being a hothead, he was a calculating master logistician. With an uncanny skill at recruiting innovative engineers, efficient quartermasters, and sound strategists, Alexander essentially invented the main disciplines of Western military organization, and so systematically and methodically dismantled the empire to the east. Macedonians, unlike earlier Greeks or contemporary Persians, usually carried their own provisions and equipment. There was no long baggage train of wagons, women, and livestock. 400 years later, Frontinus, the Roman military compiler, wrote, "When Philip organized his first army, he ordered that no one was to use a wagon. The horsemen he allowed one servant each, but for the infantry he permitted for every 10 men one attendant only, who was charged with carrying milling equipment and ropes. When the army went out during the summer, each man was ordered to carry 30 days' provisions on his back. Usually, local officials were forced to supply caches of food in advance, allowing Alexander's sleek army to hop from one depot to another." The military rhetorician of the Roman era, Polyenus, wrote that Philip made the Macedonians march 300 stadia, about 34 miles, bearing their arms and carrying as well helmets, greaves, spears, provisions, and their daily utensils. Without reconnaissance and promised food, there was simply no campaign. The enormous apparatus of travelling markets was inimical to the Macedonians' prime directive of speed, rapid onslaught, and decisive quick blows. In short, the Macedonian army travelled, in exactly the same manner, in which it attacked. Ironically, this same logistical organisation of war was also applied to sedentary operations. Bureaucratisation was clearly evident in the Macedonian mastery of polyorsetics or polis enclosure. Alexander stormed three great cities, Halicarnassus in 334 BC, Tyre and Gaza in 332 BC. All three citadels were thought to be nearly impregnable. All were reduced by engineering mastery, patience, and use of missile troops, naval contingents, and innovative artillery. Likewise, he conducted a number of smaller raiding and punishment expeditions against irregular contingents of mountaineers and mounted rebels in the mountains of Bactria, Scythia, and Afghanistan. In these asymmetrical campaigns, he organized a series of frontier forts from which heavier armed Macedonian cavalry could sortie out, holding the insurrection at bay until Alexander, through cash and promises of allegiance, could buy off rebellious satraps on the fringe of the Persian Empire. Such versatility, although reminiscent of the march of the desperate 10,000 through Persia 75 years earlier, was beyond the resources and imagination of any Greek polis of the previous two centuries. The Monster Armies. When Alexander died, an exhausted alcoholic of 33, in 323 BC, the lands he had inherited and conquered were divided among the senior Macedonian commanders in the field and back at home in Greece. Very quickly, the old guard generals Perdiccas, Craterus, and Eumenes were eliminated, and instead spheres of influence were tentatively allotted to the other surviving underlings. Antipater controlled Macedonia and Greece, Ptolemy received Egypt, Antigonus occupied Asia Minor, Seleucus inherited Mesopotamia and the east as far as India, Lysimachus retained Thrace and the lands around the Black Sea. Seleucus' subsequent victory at Ipsus, 301 BC, over Antigonus, proved that no lesser individual would inherit Alexander's entire kingdom, and so for the next century and a half, rival Macedonian dynasts fought a series of inconclusive wars throughout the Greek and Asiatic world in futile attempts to reconstitute Alexander's brief empire. For the military historian, the battles of the successors exercise an undeniable fascination. Pikes lengthen to 20 feet. Elephants make routine appearances. Enormous and garish siege engines assault cities. The treasures and other capital that flowed from the disruption of Persian hegemony made an arms race inevitable. Once unlimited money was devoted to war-making, and the technical and philosophical genius of the Greeks was applied to the new military science, organized killing became a Greek art form in itself. Throughout the Hellenistic period, continual technological sophistication refined both fortification and artillery, while ongoing debate redefined the proper role of the phalanx. In both cases, tradition often yielded to innovation. When Antigonus Gonatas, 320 to 239 BC, for example, was asked how one should attack the enemy, he simply gave the utilitarian reply, "In any way that seems useful." Nothing could ever match the sheer terror of a Macedonian phalanx. The Roman general Aemilius Paulus, who faced phalangites at Pydna in 168 BC, was left with a lifelong image of terror. Plutarch says he considered the formidable appearance of their front bristling with arms and was taken with fear and alarm. Nothing he had ever seen before was its equal. Much later, he often used to recall that sight and his own reaction to it. Nor could any enemy neglect the wide arsenal, heavy and light cavalry, light infantry, skirmishers, slingers, bowmen, and elephants that megalomaniac Hellenistic commanders theoretically might bring onto the battlefield. Nevertheless, there were inherent weaknesses in Hellenistic military practice on both a tactical and a strategic level. By the 3rd century BC, most phalangites were exclusively hired mercenaries. Gone was any vestigial sense of agrarian solidarity and civic militarism of the old Greek armies. For example, King Pyrrhus of Epirus, who died in 272 BC, reportedly told his officers, "You pick out the big men, I will make them brave." But unlike the lean forces of Philip and Alexander of even a few decades past, these much larger hired forces of the successors required enormous non-combatant support. Baggage carriers, engineers, wives, children, slaves, and markets. Such logistical and social dependence was often only haphazard and inefficiently organized. This relative sloppiness limited both the range and strategic options of large Hellenistic armies, as the occupation and control of conquered ground were increasingly a question only of cash, not of national interest, courage, or the patriotism of local citizenry. Much less was there to be lasting loyalty to either an idea or a man. More important, the phalanx itself had grown unwieldy when heavy pikes approached 20 or more feet in length, an armchair tactician's fascinating nightmare. But the tradition of cavalry symphony under Alexander was often neglected at just the period when cumbersome Macedonian infantry needed even greater integration, its flanks more, not less, protection by horsemen. Elephants and local mercenary cavalry were not the answer, as the successor generals simplistically tried to match the lost genius of Alexander with bought manpower and brute force of arms. Increased power without grace simply made the phalanx more vulnerable than ever. Polybius wrote, "The Macedonian formation is sometimes of little use, and at others of none whatsoever, since a phalangite is unable to operate either in smaller units or by himself, while the Roman formation is especially well-rounded." Legionary genesis. The emerging Roman way of war thus stood in stark contrast to the limitations of the Hellenistic military style. On a tactical level, the parochial Romans for centuries on the Italian peninsula had incorporated the old Etruscan phalanx, an institution itself borrowed from the Greeks. Indeed, throughout its later history, Rome retained a fascination with the phalanx, at times under duress bunching its legions together to seek the greater thrust of massed columns. But mobility and fluidity, not naked force, and the short sword, not the pike, gave newfound lethality to Roman infantry. In comparing legion with phalanx, Polybius simply concluded, "The Roman legionary is adaptable to any place, at any time, and for any purpose." It is difficult to talk in any meaningful way of the Roman army. After all, the Roman military evolved steadily over nearly a millennium from an instrument of republican government in the 4th century BC to authoritarian imperialism 8 centuries later, from a nucleus of Italian yeomanry to hired professionals drawn from the entire Mediterranean. The genesis of the legion, however, occurred in Italy during the 4th and 3rd centuries BC. The limitations of the Roman phalanx were ever more apparent as Rome slowly expanded throughout the Italian peninsula, finding a need to adapt its forces to a wide variety of different armies to its north, east, and south. As an example of the scope of Roman campaigning and the wide-ranging experiences of its legionaries, Livy reports the often-quoted example of the Roman citizen soldier Spurius Legustinus. In his 32-year career in the army, 200 to 168 BC, the 50-year-old recruit, father of eight, fought against Macedonian phalanxes in Greece, battled in Spain, returned to Greece to fight the Aetolians, then was back on duty in Italy, and then off again to Spain. On 4 occasions within a few years, Spurius claimed in Livy's highly rhetorical account, "I was chief centurion. 34 times I was commended for bravery by my commanders. I received 6 civic crowns for saving the life of a fellow soldier." The columnar formation of the Roman phalanx was gradually broken up into smaller tactical units called maniples, handfuls. In line with this new move to flexibility and fluidity, Roman infantrymen abandoned the spear and large round shield in favour of the curved rectangular scutum, the throwing javelin, pilum, and the short, double-edged thrusting sword, gladius. Excellent for thrusting, both of its edges cutting effectively as the blade is very strong and firm, said Polybius. By the 2nd century BC, when the Romans met the Hellenistic Greeks, a legion of men like Spurius was usually composed of about 4,200 infantry and 300 cavalry, divided into three successive lines of 10 maniples, each maniple separated from its like counterpart by about the width of its own formation. So the 10 independent maniples of each line, at least before they crashed against the enemy, had free space on both sides as well as to the front and rear. On an organizational level, Roman infantry were recruited into the legion by centuries, groups of about 60 to 70 Italian farmers led by a skilled centurion. Two centuries fought together in a maniple, one stacked behind the other. In conventional Roman battlefield order, triplex aqueus, imagine three successive lines of stacked infantry rectangles, a mile or two long checkerboard, quincunx, each maniple positioned in the gap of the line ahead. After initial skirmishing between light-armed troops and horsemen, velites, in the first line of 10 maniples, the so-called hastati, anachronistically called spearmen, approached to within about 50 to 100 yards of the enemy, then ran and flung their javelins when about 30 yards distant. With sword and shield, the hastati followed their missiles and banged into the stunned enemy line, searching for pockets of collapsed men whom their pila had just wounded or disarmed. The initial aerial barrage of pila achieved about the same terror as the traditional collision of hoplite spears, but the shorter gladius allowed the pikeless legionary far greater manoeuvrability to get inside the enemy formation with his sword and to carve at exposed limbs. At this point, the second line of Roman swordsmen, the principes, leaders, followed up. They either pushed their advancing hastati on through the opponent's line or, if the enemy proved formidable, served as a separate reserve, a second wave, battering the enemy with a fresh assault of more slashing and thrusting blades as the exhausted first line of hastati retreated through the gaps in their own advancing maniples. This second line of principes, the most rugged and skilled swordsmen of the legion, usually broke the enemy's cohesion. But failing that, the third and last manipular row, the triarii, third liners, were waiting to the rear on their knees, covering themselves with shields, spears extended. Rock-like, these 10 maniples were on the lookout for any wavering of the first two lines, giving rise to the dire proverb, "Matters have come down to the triarii." If the legion was in real trouble, desperate maniples of defeated and dejected hastati and principes could separate from each other to filter back through these protective rectangles of triarii to the palisaded camp, a resting place for the victor, a refuge for the loser. More often, however, given the frequency of Roman legionary success, in the swell of victory, the triarii also advanced cautiously and applied the coup de grace to any battlefield stragglers or crumbling formations, the enemy now seeing with the greatest terror that a new line suddenly had risen up with increased numbers. As with the phalanx, auxiliary cavalry and light-armed allies covered the flanks. An army for all seasons. Obviously, the keys to the legion's early success were coordination and adaptability, made possible by reserves and the sheer diversity of forces. Pila gave Roman infantry an offensive reach unknown to a phalanx, a deadly shower of javelins superior in lethality to the slinger's projectiles or the archer's arrows. Once inside the stunned enemy mass, the gladius could make short work of phalangites, and the tall, ovoid scutum was handy for pushing in the manner of the phalanx if maniples, once bunched together at impact, needed group thrusting power to break the solid enemy line. Spearmen to the rear prevented collapse. In a pinch, they could overwhelm confused and disorganized opposition. On a tactical level, time and space were well under control in the hands of subordinate officers, military men of education and training who could coordinate the waves of their three assaulting lines, arranging the 30 maniples of each legion to achieve either greater density or flexibility along the line as the situation required. And with so many smaller and mobile units, real articulation of forces became possible. Holding actions in the middle, flank attack, feints, retreats, and encirclements were all tactical options. At the most extreme, all maniples of the legion could coalesce horizontally. Their three lines joined vertically as well, the legion now forming an enormous quasi-phalanx to achieve greater striking power through accumulated pushing shields. Flat, unbroken terrain was not, as in the case of the phalanx, so absolutely crucial to legion cohesion, since maniples could just as easily create distance between one another in order to advance around obstacles. Indeed, rough ground that might thwart a clumsier enemy column was often welcomed. Consequently, the great variety of Roman weaponry and potential formations facilitated prompt response against tactical challenges of almost any armed enemy. Only two environments proved lethal to a Roman legion. First, under no circumstance must it become caught on narrow, flat terrain so that it might find itself, as happened at Cannae in 216 BC, trapped and squeezed between flanking enemy pincers. In these natural or man-made valleys and canyons, maniples had no chance to flow independently, but rather tended to conglomerate. And with no room to the side, individual legionaries lost their open space and the crucial ability to use their swords with advantage. Instead, like underpowered phalangites, they were funneled en masse against columns of heavier enemy spearmen, legionaries waiting in line, as it were, helpless to prevent their predictable annihilation at the fore. Just as fatal was the situation of nearly the opposite degree, unending and open treeless plains. With no real heavy cavalry and unreliable light horse, Roman legions might then become swallowed up by the sheer expanse of the terrain, harassed and goaded endlessly by mounted nomads and archers who could not be caught, much less targeted by the maniples. Under those conditions, Crassus at Carrhae, 53 BC, provides a good example. Extinction by endless aerial bombardment was slower than pulverization before a column, but just as ineluctable. The legion, then, represented the perfect culmination of existing Western military prowess. Drawing on an early Greek battle tradition of shock and decisive confrontation, coupled with the Macedonian legacy of integration and diversity of force, the pragmatic Romans achieved a marvellous balance between power and grace. With the aid of their unmatched and elaborate governmental organisation, and the capital of an expanding market economy, Romans surrounded the legionary with a rich infrastructure of war-making, roads, camps, hospitals, arms and armour, support services, pensions, salaries, medical corps, officers, and so crafted warfare as an enormous bureaucratic enterprise, its legions designed, if need be, to cope with challenges far beyond the boundaries of Italy. That their creation lasted for half a millennium is a testament to the vision and imagination of the last generation of the Roman Republic. Chapter 3. The Roman Way of War, 250 BC to AD 300. Written by Victor Davis Hansen. Incredibly enough, in the 3rd century BC, Rome expanded simultaneously eastwards against the Greeks and Macedonians, and west and south against Carthage, the great commercial and military power that had grown out of a Phoenician colony in present-day Tunisia. The three Punic Wars, 264 to 241 BC for Sicily, 218 to 201 BC for Italy and Spain, and 149 to 146 BC for Carthage itself were a struggle for the central Mediterranean which culminated in the abject destruction of Carthage. Throughout these conflicts, superior Roman military organization and infrastructure repeatedly demonstrated that the smallholders who made up the legions, as long as they fought in or near Italy, could overcome poor generalship and poor tactics, winning wars, even when they lost major battles. The emergence of a Mediterranean army. By the late 2nd and early 1st century BC, however, the Roman military faced a dilemma. Overseas expansion was outstripping traditional military capability. Near constant fighting to the north and west against the Germanic tribes, the Cimbri and Ambrones, 113 to 102 BC, to the south against the African Jugurtha in Numidia, 112 to 106 BC, and to the east against Mithridates of the Black Sea region, 96 to 82 BC, demanded either restructuring of the Republican legions or the cessation of further such intervention altogether. Roman campaigning now typically spanned the entire Mediterranean and the whole year, with little chance for legionaries to return home and farm after a series of summer battles. Garrisoning walls, forts, harbours, and entire frontiers required permanent professional troops who could master skills beyond those of mere battlefield combat, such as construction, siegecraft, and local policing. The historian Tacitus later remarked of legionary activity on the German frontier in the 1st century AD, "They complained about the difficulty of the work, and particularly about building ramparts, digging ditches, foraging, collecting lumber and firewood, and all the other camp tasks that are either necessary or else invented to keep the men busy." Often, the legions would be called on to create real infrastructure in the provinces from virtually nothing. Of their later activity as permanent garrison troops in Egypt, an anonymous Roman historian of the 4th century AD observed, "There are still to be viewed in very many parts of the Egyptian cities public works of the Emperor Probus, AD 276-82, which he had constructed by military labour. He built bridges, temples, porticos and basilicas, all by the labour of the soldiers, and he dredged many river mouths, drained a large number of marshes and converted this into good agricultural land." If Roman soldiers were to take on the combined roles of professional killers, construction workers, and occupational guards, they needed a much higher degree of training and organization. In short, by the late Republican era, the whole centuries-long tradition of amateur Roman yeoman farmers providing their own arms and armor, organized by region and led by local officers, had become completely inadequate. Native smallholders suffered enormously in the 3rd and 2nd centuries BC during the extended military absences from their farms, and yet continual overseas Roman annexation, the fruit of the legionaries' own labours, led to massive importation into Italy of non-landed capital such as slaves, cash, food, and luxury items. This plunder usually accrued to the already affluent Roman senatorial and equestrian elites, men who increasingly invested their profits in larger, more specialized and often absentee estates, prestigious Italian manors, now worked by slave gangs and managed by bailiffs. In this circular cause and effect relationship, the rise of corporate agriculture, latifundia, financed by expropriated foreign capital, led to a gradual depopulation of the Italian countryside. The very recruitment ground of the old Roman army, whose manpower had secured overseas lucre in the first place. Appian, a Roman historian of the 2nd century AD, gave a rhetorical but accurate portrayal of the dilemma of the late Republic. The wealthy, he claimed, were obtaining possession of the greater part of the undistributed lands, emboldened by the lapse of time to believe that they would never be dispossessed, absorbing any adjacent strips and their poor neighbours' allotments, partly by purchase under persuasion, partly by force, they came to cultivate vast tracts instead of single estates, using slaves as workers and herdsmen, lest free labourers be recruited into the army. At the same time, the ownership of slaves brought them great gain from the number of their offspring, who in turn multiplied because they were exempt from military service. So certain powerful men became extremely rich, and the group of servile workers grew throughout the country. All the while, the Italian people dwindled in numbers and strength, being oppressed by poverty, taxes, and military service. And if any small farmers had respite from such evils, they spent their time in idleness, because the land was held by the rich, who employed slaves as their cultivators instead of free men. This paradox somewhat resembled that facing the mature Greek city-states of the 4th century BC, when a high profile in the Mediterranean had exposed the limitations of the conventional Greek idea of restricting citizenship to its local farmers, of constructing war solely around a dominant infantry of landed yeomanry. True, the move to a professional legion and a cosmopolitan nation of assimilated peoples was a prerequisite for the sophisticated economic and military conduct of Roman imperialism, but it predictably also spelled the end of the old insular Roman agricultural state, the fountainhead of all Roman military and civic tradition. And in an even larger sense, this socio-military predicament has plagued the West repeatedly ever since. The success of dynamic armies abroad calls into question and sometimes undermines the ideological and political premises of the established social order at home. The final transition in the Roman military from yeoman infantryman to professional legionary is well illustrated by the career of the Roman general Gaius Marius, 157 to 86 BC. During the pursuit of Jugurtha, 107 to 105 BC in North Africa, Marius apparently bypassed the property qualification for Roman infantry service and, in a quest for greater manpower, equipped his legions at state expense. He also gradually normalized a 16-year rather than an indefinite term of service. Now, military recruitment of Roman citizens, as in the Hellenistic army, was to be largely separated from status or wealth. This ensured a much larger pool of potential soldiers, an army that could look exclusively to the government for both its livelihood and its retirement. Consequently, a professional legionary ostensibly welcomed rather than disdained continued work overseas in the legions. Vegetius remarked that recruits now needed only keen eyes, an erect head, broad chest, muscular shoulders, strong arms, long fingers, modest belly, thin buttocks, and tough, not fat, calves. But Marius also set a dangerous precedent in curtailing the agrarian tradition of Roman amateur militias. Professional armies, as subsequent centuries attest, could easily transfer their state allegiance to the particular general who led them, who distributed their pay, who provided their equipment, who allowed them to plunder, and above all, who pledged them retirement benefits. Demobilization during peace soon did not mean a return to agricultural work for growing hordes of Romans, but instead, no work at all and the spectre of urban unemployment and sure impoverishment. Instead of a shared rural background, much less a belief in protecting the territory of Italy, the common bond in the legions became simply the job itself, and the accompanying baser desires for cash, glory, and adventure. The Emperor Severus Alexander, AD 222 to 35, supposedly summed up later legionary ideology: "One should not fear the soldier provided he is properly clothed and well armed, and has a stout pair of boots, a full belly, and something in his money belt." To meet new military challenges in various terrains and local environments, Marius also inaugurated a series of overdue, in the strictly military sense, logistical and tactical reforms. Cohorts, usually formed of about 480 men, three times larger than the maniple of about 160, gradually evolved as the fundamental tactical unit of the legion, which was thus largely now to be defined as 10 cohorts of 4,800 soldiers. In the past, a cohort had been not much more than a loosely defined administrative organ.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.